Okay, so everybody, thank you, Puneet and the OnTop team for inviting me to conduct this lecture on neonatal transport. And transport is very vital in the survival of sick newborn babies and also in survival of premature babies. The value of transport is increases with improved tertiary care centers. So, but I'm sure that all of us have a lot of challenges in doing neonatal transport. And what I will try to do is, how do we optimize neonatal transport? And wherever possible, I'll try to see how we can innovate in reducing the challenges related to transport. So the goals of my presentation are, what is the goal of, objective of my presentation are, what are the goal of transport? When do we transport newborns? And what is the process of transport? What equipment are required? Who should form the team of the transport? And what is the evidence related to neonatal transport? And I will also touch upon some indigenous methods to improve the neonatal transport. So the goal of neonatal transport is that the right newborn has to be taken at the right time by the right people to the right place by the right form of transport and receive the right care throughout. So I hope we understand this definition. The right newborn means obviously the baby we should transport only babies who require transport. And obviously there is a time at which we transport, because if say for instance respiratory distress syndrome, if you transport early, then you might start the baby on CPAP and surfactant. But if you delay the process, the baby may go in for severe RDS and thereby may need mechanical ventilation. So our decision to transport should be at the right time and with the right people. So people doing transport should be well trained. The nurses, the doctors, the ambulance drivers, the helpers, all of them should be knowing how to play their role in neonatal transport and to the right place. So obviously you have to transport to the place where the facilities for taking care of the sick newborn are available and by the right mode form of transport. It could be road transport, rail transport, or water transport or air transport. We should know which transport we have to use. Long distance, we can think of air transport, but short distances, we think of road transport. And throughout this transport process, the baby should get the right care. So transport the sick neonate to the nearest facility by the fastest method and the shortest route. This should be the goal. We should transport the baby to the nearest facility where facilities are available by the fastest method and by the shortest route. However, although we are talking about neonatal transport, the safest and the best way to transfer a newborn baby is in utero. So it's better to refer the mother if the baby is expected to have a malformation, if the baby is expected to be very preterm, or if the baby is going to be a very low birth weight baby. So which babies need transport? These are the common indications for transport world over and also in our country. Extremely low, very low birth weight babies, that is babies less than 34 weeks and less than 1500 grams. Asphyxiated babies, babies who are not able to breathe, and the 5-minute apgar is less than 5. These are the babies who may require therapeutic hypothermia, ventilation and multi-organ support, and those requiring seizures or those having multiple seizures. Severe sepsis is a special indication in our country, where sepsis continues to kill many of our babies. So babies, when they are having severe sepsis, like off color, prolonged circulation, cold peripheries, babies dull, may require multi-organ support. These babies will definitely require transport to a tertiary care facility. Those babies requiring jaundice, requiring the exchange transfusion, and if phototherapy machines are available but exchange facilities are not available, then these babies will require transport to higher facilities. Malformations would require surgical intervention, so we should transport to places where pediatric surgery facilities are available and neonatal ventilation facilities also should be available simultaneously. So like in CDH, intestinal obstruction, tracheal fistula, the neonatal unit and the surgical unit should be working together. In bleeding neonates, we need to transport sometimes if the bleeding is heavy and babies require multiple blood transfusions or fresh frozen plasma or blood components. So very rarely babies need to be transported for investigations like ROP screening, laser for ROP, EEG, and also for MRI. So these are special conditions where we need to transport the baby from the hospital to outside the hospital, from the home to hospital, and so on. So when do we should not transport babies? When we have local facilities available for taking care of this baby, we should try to, because we said we should transport to the rarest facilities by the fastest route and the shortest, fastest method and the shortest route. So if the local facilities are available for level 3 facilities, there is no point in shifting the baby to another place. Unlikely to survive, or unlikely to survive with a quality of life. 500 gram babies with IVH grade 4, or babies with severe CDH where prenatal it was diagnosed to have a lung head ratio less than 1. So, or an anencephaly, or a multiple malformations, so critical complex congenital heart diseases, where quality of life is going to be low, or where the surgical intervention may not bring out optimum outcomes, those babies we should not transport. And sometimes it may be difficult for logistic reasons like the weather conditions are not conducive. So till the conditions are conducive, we need to manage the baby at the local facility. And experienced staff or team is not available and condition likely to deteriorate during the transport, or other things, the reasons why babies are not transported. Sometimes it might be better to treat at the local place rather than transport suboptimally, because during the transport, the babies are likely to get into more problems like pulmonary hypertension, hypothermia, hypoglycemia. So these problems might add on to the existing problems of the newborn. So basically, when we talk about transport, we are talking about in-hospital transport and inter-hospital transport, or community to hospital transport, and the method of transport could be road, water, or air. Now, home to sub-center, to PSC, to area hospital, to SNCU and medical college. So this could be the way the transport could happen. And this is how an ideal regionalization care should happen. So, but there might be a baby who is at sub-center who may wanting to be shipped to medical college because the baby has a malformation requiring pediatric surgery. So the transport should be direct from sub-center to medical college. So, but baby is 1.8 kg, can be taken care in SNCU, then baby should be shifted to SNCU. So we should know where to shift these babies from one hospital to another, and also from community to the hospital. So the methods of transport. So the method would depend upon the distance to be traveled and available local facilities and condition of the requirement or infant requiring emergent care. So there might be some time where we need to transport within 24 hours. And then conditions, maybe you have to fly the baby from one place to another so that the critical heart disease can be managed surgically. So once we have decided to transport, so what do we do to stabilize the baby before we transport the baby? For that, we need to consider three important things. We need to assess the baby's condition. We need to assess in various modalities. We need to support and monitor the baby before we transport and maintain the support while the baby is being transported. So what do we assess? We need to assess airway, breathing, circulation, and metabolism. So these are the four things which we need to assess in the baby. And there are some mnemonics to remember, and these mnemonics are almost the same, but they should be understood that they involve basically airway, breathing, circulation, and metabolism, and sometimes other things like family support, investigation. These are also part of the stabilization. The stable mnemonic help us to understand that we need to stabilize the sugar, temperature, maybe baby should be intubated and started on bag and mask or tube and bag. Blood pressure should be controlled by giving a bolus and starting inotropes, and lab support and in lab should be sent, and emotional support of the parents before transport is very essential. So these should be stabilized before we transport the baby. The other mnemonic is safer. Again, sugar, circulation, family support, environment, and respiratory support are the components of safer. They all are, although mnemonics are different, but they all contain the same components of airway, breathing, circulation, medication, and family care. And in the stops, which is very simple to remember, it considers that you have to stabilize the sugar, give a bolus if the baby has hypoglycemia, temperature should be controlled, brought to normal temperature, oxygenation, you should use either prongs or oxygen or by CPAP or by tube and bag before you stabilize, before you shift the baby to higher center. Perfusion, again, boluses and inotropes can be used. And sensorium, you need to see if the baby has a seizure, you should control the seizure. And if the baby has hypoglycemia, control it before you shift the baby to higher center. So monitoring should be of temperature, airway, mainly check for the neck position, pleural malformations related to airways, breathing support and what type of breathing support can be assessed on the respiratory rate and precession. And circulation, you can assess from periphery, scapular refill time, saturation and blood pressure, and thereby you can think of giving fluid, inotropes like dopamine, dobutamine, and other medications. And sometimes circulation, you need to see that if the baby is severely cyanotic and if you are suspecting heart disease, adenosine can be started off. Then ECG and chest X-ray, if needed, should be done before transport. And we need to analyze that if it's a critical heart disease or if it's a cyanotic heart disease, treatment can be started before we shave the baby. So the monitoring of not only of the baby, we need to monitor the equipment which needs to be accompanying the baby, like availability of incubator, multi-channel monitor, oxygen cylinder gas level, lines and tubes are in place or not, and neonate is securely placed or not. So all this monitoring should be done. No, so first you assess the baby, then you start monitoring the baby and the facilities which are required for shifting the baby to higher center. So we have already discussed that sugar should be controlled, temperature should be controlled by using warmer, hot water bottle, kangaroo mother care, or sometimes face changing material like embrace. Oxygen can be given by one of the methods. Perfusions can be controlled by establishing a cannula or a central line and then giving boluses, inotropes, and vitamin K. And if the baby's sensorium is not good, control hypoglycemia and seizure should be controlled using one of the AEDs. So those are the general pre-transport stabilization, but there are certain conditions where you need to be little more proactive in controlling the baby or stabilizing baby before you transport. Like if a baby with preterm RDS, maybe you should start the baby on CPAP and intubate and give surfactant even before you shift the baby for higher center. Pneumothorax, it's not worth to shift the baby on tension pneumothorax. So if tension pneumothorax is there, either put a drain and then shift the baby or use a chest tube and drain the pneumothorax and then shift the baby rather than shifting the baby with a tension pneumothorax. If the baby has shock, control the shock with fluid inotropes and then shift the baby. If the baby is bleeding, since the commonest cause of bleeding is hemorrhagic disease of newborn, give it a dose of vitamin K and then shift the baby to higher center. Seizure control, you can try to use dextrose, calcium, and then AEDs in that order. And then after the seizures are controlled, you can shift the baby to higher center. So there are certain specific things. There are certain general things. The general things are related to airway, breathing, circulation, and metabolism, and also the equipment. And the specific things are related to the disease status, what you should do before you shift the baby to higher center. So if you're suspecting a critical heart disease, maybe it might be worth to start the baby on prostaglandin infusion and then shift the baby to higher center. Or if you're suspecting a PSVT where the heart rate is more than 250 and you do an ECG showing typical PSVT, maybe it might be worth to give a dose of adenosine and start the baby on propranolol and then shift the baby rather than shifting the baby with a heart rate of 250 to higher center in that situation. So the stabilization can be standardized by using checklists. And whenever possible, you also make sure that the mother accompanies the baby or the, because many times mother's blood is required to cross match or to give blood to the baby or do exchange transfusion. But it's ideal to accompany the baby with the mother or mother with the baby. Otherwise, at least write the baby's blood group in the trans referral route and take a sample of blood in ADT vial and send with the baby. Now, if they be, especially in babies who require exchange transfusion, the referral note should be clear, should indicate prenatal, natal history, the need for transfer, and where you are transferring. And obviously, you need to communicate with the receiving team, that is the transfer team, the status of the baby, the need for transport, and the time required to reach the referral center. So these can be communicated so that the referral receiving team can be prepared even before the baby comes to their facility. So during transport, obviously the facilities are exactly the same which are there before transport. Again, during transport also, you need to continue to assess the baby for airway, breathing, circulation, metabolic support, and monitor the baby to throughout transport and maintain these ABCDE while transfer is happening. So again, the same four things you have to ensure that entire process of transport, we continue with this. So during transport, again, maintain temperature, ensure that the airway is open, oral and nasal suction may be required sometimes, and breathing should be supported either with oxygen, HFNC, CPAP, or ventilation. And if the circulation is there, maybe fluids, anatropes should be continued, and you need to assess the saturation, heart rate, blood pressure, even during transport. And avoid doing emergency procedures in a running vehicle, especially the baby ET tube need to be replaced, or is the UVC to be placed, or is the chest tube need to be reinserted. You can stop the vehicle by the roadside, ensure that these are replaced and refixed, and then you continue to shift the baby again. So avoid doing major procedures while the vehicle is running. You should stop if the baby deteriorates on the way and you need to do a CPR. It is better to stop the vehicle and do the resuscitation rather than continuing resuscitation in a running vehicle. And always continue to record the vitals and the events which happen during the transport in a referral note, and also maintain the monitoring chart during the from the place of transferring to the receiving team. And communicate, always continue to communicate with the receiving team if there is anything fresh, things have happened, if the baby had a seizure or the baby needs a chest tube as soon as they go there. So you should communicate with the referral receiving team so that they are prepared to do emergency management apart from what you are doing in the vehicle. And while the transport is happening, you have to ensure that the incubator is in the air mode, the temperature of the baby is maintained, and the monitors are well fixed, and you are able to continuously see the aspiration, SpO2s, heart rates, and respiratory rates. The cylinder gas levels, especially the oxygen cylinder level, should be constantly checked, because most of the cylinders, if you're giving 10 liters to 15 liters, they may work only for 3 to 4 hours. So you need to understand that you need to replace the cylinder if the gas is getting over. So the lines and tubes could be constantly checked for, because there is a high chance that these tubes and lines can get displaced while doing the transport. And the neonate should be securely placed while the transport is happening in the incubator, or if you're doing a transport in a embrace, the baby should be well flexed. And ensure that the tubes and lines are also well fixed with the machine in which the baby is transported. Now, once you finish up at the receiving end, when you're handing over the baby to the receiving team, you should hand over the case history. What happened during your transport? Have you done anything special? Monitoring chart during transport. And also give them the investigations which they have sent, and so that there is no need to repeat all those investigations. There are radiographs already done that should be handed over, and all the prenatal natal reports should be handed over to the receiving team, and the transfer form should be handed over, and all this should be communicated to the parents as well as to the receiving team. So the transfer form should have the timing, date and time of transport, and the critical event which happened. There is something called turnaround time or PAT time. When did you start and when did you reach the referring team? This is one very important way to see whether how much is the PAT time. That will help you to assess the quality of transport which you're doing. And also at the receiving team, they would check the blood pressure, they will check the temperature and sugar. These are again quality indicators of your transport. So the referral note or the transfer note should have clinical baseline history, what clinical interventions were done, investigations carried out, and the results, what is the condition of the baby during transport, and name of the responsible clinicians at each state of the transport. Who was the clinician at the time of referral? Who was managing the baby during transport? And who is the clinician who is going to manage the baby at the receiving end? And parents' details should always be ensured that they are noted down in the transfer form. Especially in the private, some more issues which come up are the financial aspect. The communication should happen before transferring for the financial aspect, rather than baby comes to the receiving teams and then they realize that they cannot afford or they cannot manage the baby in that place. So the whole transport will become a futile unless you do the financial counseling also before shifting the baby to higher centers. So who takes the responsibility and the liability? Where does the liability fall? The liability and the responsibility is a combined effort. As soon as the baby is started, lifted from the referral center, the team who is doing the transport, the responsibility falls on them. And once the receiving team receives the baby and the condition of the baby is recorded at the receiving team, the responsibility and the liability will fall on the receiving team. Always, always, once the baby is received in the referral team, it is important to give the feedback both to the transport team and also to the referral doctors. And what happened during transport and how the baby came to you, so that tomorrow they can improve on their quality of transport. And if there was hypothermia, hypoglycemia, we should inform them so that they can do a better transport in the future. Both the transport team and the referral team should be aware what happened to the baby during transport and what is the status of the baby at the time of receiving in the referral hospital. Now, we have seen the process of transport. What do you do pre-transport? What do you do during transport? And what do you do after the baby is received in the receiving center? So what equipment are received required for transport? So if you see, there is a plethora of equipment which are required, or there are lots and lot of things are required, but these can be simply understood that these all fall under airway, breathing, circulation, and cardiac or metabolic support. If you remember that ABCD, you will understand that all the things will fall under these four or five headings only. So look at here. So these are some emergency things which should be available, like the laryngoscope, the Meigel's forceps, bag and mask, and BP cuffs, intraosseous needles, IV set, oxygen packs, IV packs, and intubation packs. So for temperature control, you can think of these. These are innovations which people have used. The thermocol box, where baby is wrapped in a nice cloth and then put in a thermocol box. This is nothing but a phase contrast material is used to warm the baby. It's called embrace. And this is the best method so far, looks like if the baby can tolerate on the mother's tummy or in the kangaroo mother care. So these are the key innovative methods of keeping the baby's temperature warm, and using appropriate optimum temperatures, we can transport the babies very effectively. For the respiratory or the airways, so you need a suction catheter, you need a suction machine or a suction pump, and you need oxygen by hood. But obviously, we are not supposed to give 100% oxygen. So you need to have a venturi connected to the hood if you're giving hood oxygen, and or you can use nasal prongs, the oxygen cylinders, and how much time, whether it's a full cylinder or empty cylinder, you should know. And ideally, now we know that blenders also should be used during transport, because brief exposures of hyperoxia is going to damage the eyes and the brains of the baby. TPs, another innovative method of transport. If it's a short transport, a few hours, 1 or 2 hours, I think TPs is very useful, and it can replace the modern ventilators. A TPs can give you both PEEP, PIP, and also blended oxygen. For circulatory support, you need syringe and infusion pumps. You need the set for putting IV cannula, or for a PICC line, or for umbilical line. And you may have to need multiple syringe pumps, because babies may require fluids, inotropes, and other medications. The commonest medications required are calcium, epinephrine, soda bicarb, normal saline, ringer lactate, dopamine, dobutamine, midazolam, phenobarbitone, phenytoin, adenosine, prostaglandin, and surfactant. These are the common medicines which are available in most of the transport kits related to newborn transport. And monitoring devices, these are again innovative devices where you can see, you can put a watch on the baby and the temperature can be constantly monitored on the mobile phone, or you need a stethoscope, you need digital thermometers, and you need appropriate gadgets like a multi-channel monitor or a pulse oximeter. And you should understand that these monitors should be well fixed onto the ambulance or to the trolley, so that these monitors do not get displaced while transport. It may be simple things, maybe just having a BP cuff, like a very cost-effective BP cuff can be there. Cost-effective pulse oximeters are available. And you need to have always the glucometer. And sometimes blood gas machines also, portable machines also can be used to transport before and during transport. Yes, this would be the ideal one, that you have everything fitting into one small machine. This is a transport incubator. You have a transport incubator, you have a transport ventilator. It has an inbuilt compressor, it has a blender, and it has got a oxygen cylinders where you can place oxygen cylinders under the incubator. And it also has a suction machine. And these trolleys are very lightweight trolleys, which can be easily lifted, or they can be shifted from the ground onto the ambulances very easily. So now we know what equipment is required. Basically, I said equipment is related to temperature management, respiratory management, airway and respiratory management, circulatory management. So if you remember those things, and some medications, you will cover mostly 80 to 90% of equipment which is required for transport. Now, regarding the transport team, yes, you will require one physician or a pediatrician or a neonatologist. The smaller the baby, the more should be the skill of the person doing the transport. Definitely a neonatal nurse should accompany. There will be a need for one more assistant. And obviously a driver should be there. Who knows to check for the gas levels? Mainly the compressed gas sources should be constantly checked. The capability of the team, the ability of the team to manage during transport are very, very important parameters which would assess the success of a transport. The more the transport team does, the more the capable they're going to be. So in this transport team, there are two types. One is a dedicated neonatal transport team, and there is, or that is a standalone transport team. The other is where hospital-based, unit-based transport teams. So both have their own plus and minuses, but in some countries like Australia, New Zealand, and UK, they have a dedicated transport team where the transport team is different from the team which take care of the babies in the receiving hospitals. So they do land transport, they do air transport, and they do the water transport. Having that would be the ideal, but otherwise there will be a lot of, each unit has a transport team that is going to be not very cost effective. So it's having a regionalized transport system will be a very effective way in places where a lot of hospitals and babies are coming from different places. So the educational and experiential background of the transport team should be adequately addressed to. They should have good clinical and technical expertise. Leadership skills should be adorned, and they should have critical thinking skills, because if you see a tension pneumothorax, they should first drain and then shift the baby. So they should know what to do when, and that means they should be reading well, and they should have some more skill and experience. And they should have good communication and interpersonal skills, because you need to explain to the parents and to the receiving referral team what you're going to do, what is going to happen during the transport and after transport. Appreciation of public and community relations. These are some special aspects of the transport team which can be improved on. So there is some checklists which are readily available. These are things which help you to ensure that you have assessed the baby, you have assessed the equipment, and you know you've taken the history, and you are monitoring the baby during transport, and what you're monitoring, how you're logging the events during transport. All these are available in checklist form, so that you do not forget, and this should be adhered to always, because there are a lot many things are done before during transport, and that's why it's very important to have a checklist. And before every transport, the checklist should be followed or should be addressed to. So what is the evidence which is related to neonatal transport? So preterm babies delivered in a tertiary care center appear to have improved outcomes when compared with preterm newborns transferred to tertiary care after birth. That means in utero transfer is always, always better than transferring the baby after birth. Second, outborn versus born at tertiary care hospital. That is the same point, that if your baby is sick and is born in tertiary care hospital where NICU facilities are good, death and major morbidities are reduced. The incidence of severe IVH and incidence of CLD and IVH are dramatically reduced. So this is a study which has shown what happens if the babies are transported after birth versus babies are taken care in hospital. So across the board, you can see that mortality is higher for referred babies rather than babies born in hospital. And all the morbidities are higher in percentage compared to the babies who are born in hospital. The second thing is, it is no longer appropriate that small hedgehog team undertake occasional ill-prepared and hazardous transport, often with absolute equipment and minimal expertise. So which means that the more transport you do, the more equipped you become to give a quality transport and also to take care of the communication and also social aspects of transport. So everything matters. So that's why it is better to be the team. If it is a standalone team, that's going to be ideal, but at least you should have people who have some experience in doing transport, then only the outcomes are going to be better. Transferring critically ill neonates without specialized staff results in greater morbidity and mortality, like higher hypoglycemia, higher hypothermia, hypoxia, and infection. So it's always better to develop a nurse-led neonatal transport team. This is what is going to happen in the Western world. They are more moving towards the nurse-led neonatal team, especially in our countries where doctors to population ratio is very low. Maybe there is a need for us to work on nurse practitioners or nurse-led neonatal teams so that our quality of transport can improve on. So one end, we need to innovate. At the other end, we need to follow, also improve the skills of transport so that babies' outcomes can be improved. So to summarize, neonatal transport is an important component of regionalized perinatal care. Neonatal transport, when we think of the process, we need to have pre-transport assessment, monitoring, and stabilization. The same thing should continue during the transport. And we should understand the transport methods, that is inter-hospital, intra-hospital, or back referral. And we should know the equipment which is required. And we should understand that the core team core components will have a huge role in improving the outcomes of transport. However, evidence supports organized neonatal transports. That means there is a particular way the transports have to be done, and all the following all the checklists and also following the SOPs will improve the outcomes of babies who are transported from one facility to other facility or within the facility, like from labor rooms to the NICUs. So thank you, and I hope you enjoyed this lecture, and I'll wait for questions from you people. Any questions? So you can write in the chat box. Or Puneet, can you unmute them if they can raise their hand so that we can ask, we can answer the question. So if there are no questions, so shall we stop then?